In the context of unconstrained optimization, we used the gradient in order to characterize the optimal solution. Indeed, the gradient measures the slope of the function, and we could find local optimum at points where the slope was null, was zero. But in the context of linear optimization, the gradient is constant. But we will use it in order to calculate the slope of the objective function along feasible directions. So let's consider a linear optimization problem written in standard form. So it's characterized by the matrix A, which has m rows corresponding to the m equality constraints, and n columns corresponding to the n variables of the problem, B, which is the right-hand side of the equality constraints, and C, which are the coefficients of the objective function. Suppose that we have decomposed A into a basis matrix and a non-basis matrix, and for the sake of simplicity, let's assume that the basic variables are the m first variables. You can always do this by renumbering the variables. So we know how to calculate a vertex of the polyhedron. It's a basic solution. Okay, X is decomposed into basic variables and non-basic variables. The non-basic variables are set to 0, and the basic variables are equal to b minus 1, b. And we have also seen how to calculate a basic direction. A basic direction is obtained when you want to take the variable j, which is out of the basis, and you want to make it positive. In this case, the non-basic part of the direction here is composed of vector ej, which is a vector with all zeros except a 1 at the j's position. And the basic part of the direction is calculated as minus b minus 1 aj. So this is what we have seen in previous chapters of this course. Now let's consider a basic direction, which is typically a direction that we want to follow in order to visit the vertices of the polyhedron. And now let's calculate the slope of the objective function along this direction. So if you remember, the slope of a function along a direction is called the directional derivatives, and this is the inner product of the gradient and the direction. So here the gradient of the function is simply vector c. So what we want to calculate is c transpose dj. So now we decompose c into a basic part and a non-basic part. So I have cb transpose djb plus cn transpose djn. And now we use the definition of dj here, and we obtain minus cb transpose b minus 1 aj for the basic part. And for the non-basic part, remember, djn here is a vector which has 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, with a 1 at the j's location. So it means that when you multiply it with the vector cn, only the entry number j will contribute to this inner product. So we have here cj. So we have shown here that if j is the index of a non-basic variable, this quantity here is the slope of the objective function along the corresponding basic direction. And this quantity will be called the reduced cost. So this is the definition of the reduced cost. So it's the quantity that we just calculated. We have seen that for non-basic variables, this reduced cost is the slope of the objective function along the corresponding basic direction. This is how we have derived the quantity. So now let's calculate a reduced cost for the basic variables. And in order to do that, we have to remember that the matrix B, which is the basis matrix, contains the columns of A corresponding to the basic variables. And in this example, j is the index of a basic variable. It means that the multiplication of b minus 1 and aj will simply be the column number j of the identity matrix that we denote by ej, and which is a vector that contains all zero except at the j's entry which is 1. So it means that we have here Cj minus Cb transpose Ej. And this inner product, all the terms are 0 except the term number j. So we have Cj minus Cj. And this is equal to 0. Good. So it means that if we take the reduced cost that we have actually derived for non-basic variables and calculate it for basic variables, we obtain 0. So reduced cost for basic variables are always 0. So now we can write the reduced cost in matrix form. It's the vector C minus A transpose B minus transpose CB. And this belongs to Rn. It's defined for all the variables. Now, the good thing is that these reduced costs allow us to write sufficient optimality conditions for the linear optimization problem. And these conditions are simple. If the reduced costs are all non-negative, then X star is optimal. Remember that for basic variables, the reduced costs are 0. So we don't even need to check them. So when we want to check for optimality condition, for sufficient optimality condition, we just need to check the non-basic variables. So somehow, what does this condition say is that if along each basic direction, the function is going up, remember, the reduced cost is the slope of the objective function along the basic direction. So if the function is going up in all basic directions, then we are at an optimal of the problem. Let's illustrate this on a simple example. So here I have represented a simple optimization problem. So we have two variables, x1 and x2, and the function is minus x1 minus 2x2, and this is represented by this plane here that is plotted on this picture. And here is the constrained polyhedron. So the constrained polyhedron is represented here on the floor, and it's projected onto the function so that we see it better. And now I'm considering this point here, which is one vertex of the constrained polyhedron. At this vertex, there are two basic directions, one here and one here. We can see them better here. We have one here that goes along this face and one here that goes along this face. And as you can see from this picture, the function is increasing along these two directions. Algebraically speaking, it means that the reduced costs are positive. All reduced costs are positive. So we are at a minimum. Now we need to realize that the reduced cost being non-negative is a sufficient optimality condition, but it's not necessary. It means that we may have an optimum solution such that the reduced cost may be negative, or some reduced cost may be negative. We'll try to illustrate this on an example. So we have here the same problem as before, but I have modified it a little bit by adding this additional constraint here that intersects the polyhedron exactly at the solution. And the condition is that this constraint must be verified with inequality. So this is the feasible set. So actually, all feasible solutions of the previous example verify this additional constraint, so it doesn't change anything in terms of the optimal solution. But if you calculate the reduced cost of these constraints, well, depending on the basic representation, you may end up with a situation like this, where this direction, which is a basic direction, it goes down. It goes down, so it means that the reduced cost associated with it is negative. But if you look carefully at this picture, you see that this direction is not feasible. I cannot follow it because I would go out of the polyhedron. We are in the context of a degenerate solution. Remember, a degenerate solution is a feasible basic solution such that some of the basic variables are zero. And when we introduced this concept earlier on, we mentioned that this may cause some problems. And this is the first problem that it may generate, because some of the basic directions may be infeasible. We may be at a solution like here and have one of the reduced costs to be negative. So if you want to write a necessary optimality condition, you need to assume that the solution, the basic feasible solution, is non-degenerate. In this case, the reduced cost being non-negative is a necessary condition. If X star is optimum, then all reduced costs are non-negative. So as we saw in the example, if the basic solution is degenerate, it may be possible that one reduced cost is negative, even if the solution is optimum. In this case, we know that it is interpreted as a descent direction, so the function decreases along that direction, but because X star is optimal, it means that the direction is infeasible, as we saw in the example. So the reduced cost represents the slope of the objective function along basic directions. This is how it is defined for all non-basic variables. For basic variables, we have seen that the reduced cost is zero. And this reduced cost provides us a sufficient condition of optimality. If all reduced costs are non-negative, the associated vertex is optimal. We have seen that it's not a necessary condition. It will be a necessary condition only in the case where the solution, the optimal solution, is non-degenerate. In this case, we have the guarantee that all the reduced costs will be non-negative. But if the optimal solution is degenerate, we may have an optimal vertex with a basis representation such that one of the basic directions is a descent direction. But in this case, of course, it's infeasible because we are at an optimum, so we cannot follow a descent direction.